Ohm's law, it explains relation between the pressure, flow and the resistance in the blood vessels. Blood flow through a vessel, it is determined by two factors, pressure difference and the vascular resistance. Here we can see this is a given blood vessel and the blood flow through the blood vessel. Now this blood flow through this blood vessel, it depends on the pressure difference and the resistance. Here we can see P1. P1 is the pressure which is present at the first point. P2, it is the pressure which is present at the second point. And the pressure gradient between these two points is the delta P. Delta P is equal to P1 minus P2. Resistance is the impediment which is offered to the blood flow. So the blood flow through the blood vessel, it depends on the pressure gradient as well as the resistance. Blood flow through the blood vessel, it can be calculated by Ohm's law. So according to the Ohm's law, blood flow through the vessel, it is directly related to the pressure gradient and it is inversely related to the resistance. So blood flow F is equal to delta P divided by R. It means blood flow, it is directly proportional to the pressure difference. So as the pressure difference increases, it increases the blood flow, and it is inversely related to the resistance. So as the resistance or the impediment to the blood flow increases, it decreases the blood flow, and as the resistance decreases, it increases the blood flow. So the Ohm's law, it describes the relationship between the blood flow, pressure difference and the resistance across the blood vessel. Ohm's law, it is also helpful to understand more about the resistance to the blood flow. Resistance is the impediment to the blood flow inside the vessel. Now this resistance, it cannot be measured by any direct means. Now according to the Ohm's law, blood flow inside the vessel is equal to delta P, or the pressure difference across the two points inside the blood vessel, divided by resistance offered. So F is equal to delta P divided by R. So R is equal to delta P divided by F. So resistance offered is equal to pressure difference divided by blood flow. So resistance, it can be calculated if the blood flow as well as the pressure difference across two points in the vessel is known. For example, if the pressure difference across the blood vessel is 1 mmHg and the blood flow is 1 ml per second, then the resistance offered R is equal to delta P divided by F is equal to 1 PRU. Here PRU is equal to peripheral resistance unit. Now let's calculate total peripheral vascular resistance and the total pulmonary vascular resistance. First of all, the total peripheral vascular resistance. As we all know, cardiac output is 5 to 6 liter per minute or the 100 ml per second. So the rate of the blood flow through the entire circulatory system is 100 ml per second. And the pressure difference from systemic arteries to the systemic vein is about 100 mmHg. So the resistance of the entire systemic circulation or the total peripheral resistance is equal to pressure difference delta P, that is 100 mmHg divided by blood flow across the systemic circulation or 100 ml per second is equal to 1 PRU. So the total peripheral resistance is about 1 PRU. Now peripheral resistance, it depends on the diameter of the blood vessel. So whenever strong vasoconstriction occurs, then it increases total peripheral resistance up to 4 PRU, and the vasodilatation or increase in the diameter of the blood vessel, it can decrease the total peripheral resistance up to 0.2 PRU. Now in the pulmonary system, the mean pulmonary arterial pressure, it averages about 16 mmHg, and the mean left atrial pressure, it averages about 2 mmHg. So the net pressure difference is equal to 16 minus 2 is equal to 14 mmHg. So delta P, or the pressure difference inside the pulmonary vascular system, is the 14 mmHg. Now the cardiac output is normal or same in both the systemic as well as the pulmonary system. So even in the pulmonary system, cardiac output is 5 to 6 liter per minute, and in ml per second it is about 100 ml per second. So the total pulmonary vascular resistance is equal to pressure difference delta P, that is 14 mmHg, divided by blood flow in the pulmonary circulation, that is 100 ml per second, is equal to 0.14 PRU. So the pulmonary vascular resistance is 0.14 PRU, that is about 1/7 that is present inside the systemic circulation. So always remember that the vascular resistance inside the pulmonary system, it is lower than the systemic circulation. Conductance of the blood in the vessel is the reciprocal or the inversely related to the resistance. Now, conductance is a measure of the blood flow through a vessel for a given pressure difference. So conductance is equal to 1 divided by resistance. So whenever resistance increases, then it decreases conductance or decreases the blood flow at the given pressure difference. And whenever resistance decreases, then it increases blood flow at the given pressure difference. Now, small changes in the vessel diameter, it markedly changes its conductance, because conductance, it is directly proportional to the fourth power of the diameter. So whenever diameter increases, then it increases conductance of the blood flow through the given vessel. And whenever diameter decreases, then it decreases blood flow at the given pressure difference. Here we can see the pressure difference is 100 mmHg and the diameter of the blood vessel at 1, 2 and the 4. So whenever diameter of the blood vessel is 1, the blood flow is 1 ml per minute, diameter is 2, then blood flow is 16 ml per minute, where diameter is 4, then blood flow is 256 ml per minute. So the conductance, it is related to the fourth power of the diameter. In the small vessel, blood flow at the given pressure difference is less, and whenever diameter of the blood vessel is large, then the blood flow at a given pressure difference is more. In the Ohm's law, we have learned about the relationship between the pressure, flow and the resistance. Now let's understand about the relationship between the resistance, viscosity and the radius of the vessel, and it is explained by the Poiseuille's law. So according to the Hagan-Poiseuille's law, Q, or the flow rate, is equal to P1 minus P2 multiplied with pi r s to 4 divided by 8 eta L. Q is the flow rate across the blood vessel. P1 minus P2 is the pressure difference across the blood vessel. R is the radius of the blood vessel. Eta is the viscosity of the blood. And L is the length of the blood vessel. So Hagan-Poiseuille's law, it describes the relationship between the Q, that is the flow rate, P1 minus P2, that is the pressure difference, R is the radius of the vessel, and eta is the viscosity of the blood. So flow rate across the vessel, it is directly related to the pressure difference across the blood vessel. It is directly related to the fourth power of the radius of the vessel, and it is inversely related to the viscosity and the length of the vessel. So as the pressure difference across the vessel increases, blood flow increases. As the radius of the vessel increases, then flow rate across the vessel increases. And whenever viscosity of the blood increases, then the flow rate across the blood vessel, it decreases. Now we will utilize the information from the Hagan-Poiseuille's law to understand more about the peripheral resistance. So according to the Hagan-Poiseuille's law, Q, or the flow rate, is equal to P1 minus P2 multiplied with pi r s to 4 divided by 8 eta L. Now, according to the Ohm's law, Q or the flow rate is equal to delta P divided by R. So, R is equal to delta P divided by Q. Now, we will add all the values of the Q from the Egan-Poiseuille's law inside the Ohm's law. So, peripheral resistance R is equal to P1 minus P2 divided by P1 minus P2 multiplied with pi raised to 4 divided by 8 eta L. So, here we can see the peripheral resistance R is equal to 8 eta L divided by pi raised to 4. So, peripheral resistance, it is related to the viscosity directly, and inverse relationship is present between the peripheral resistance and the radius of the vessel. So, this describes the relationship between the peripheral resistance, viscosity, and the radius of the vessel. Viscosity of the blood, it increases in various conditions which changes the hematocrit. For example, in polycythemia, viscosity of the blood increases, which can increase the peripheral resistance. And peripheral resistance, it is inversely related to the fourth power of the radius of the vessel. So whenever radius of the blood vessel changes, then it changes the peripheral resistance. For example, when we reduce the diameter of the blood vessel to half, then it increases the peripheral resistance to 16 times, because peripheral resistance, it is inversely related to the fourth power of the radius of the vessel. So even small change in the radius of the vessel, it can change the peripheral resistance tremendously. Length of the blood vessel, it is always constant, so we can ignore the length of the vessel while considering the factors affecting the peripheral resistance. Now, after understanding all the factors affecting the peripheral resistance, understand about the resistance to the blood flow in the series as well as in the parallel vascular circuits. So, after the pumping of the blood from the heart in the systemic circulation, blood flows in the great vessels like aorta. From great vessels, blood flow inside the arteries, arterioles, capillaries, venules, and vein. So, blood flows from one vessel into the another vessel. That is a series of the blood vessel. But simultaneously, blood flows in the parallel circuits. From one vessel, it circulates into the other vessels simultaneously. For example, from the artery, blood flows inside the arterioles. Now, these multiple arterioles, they provide blood flow to the capillaries. So, this is a parallel type of the circuits. So, understand about the resistance to the blood flow in the series as well as in the parallel vascular circuit, it is different. Let's understand it by example. So, first of all, when blood flows in series means from one vessel, blood flows inside the other vessel. So, here we can see this is the first vessel, and R1 is the peripheral resistance of this first vessel. This is the second vessel, and this is the resistance of the second vessel, that is R2. And blood flows from one vessel into the other vessel. Peripheral resistance, it depends on the viscosity of the blood as well as the radius of the vessel. So if the radius of the second vessel, it is different, then the resistance of the second vessel, it is also changed. Now, the total resistance of this circuit which is in the series is equal to resistance of the first vessel plus resistance of the second vessel plus third and fourth and so on. So, we will just add the resistance of all the vessels in the series, and it will give us information about the total peripheral resistance. Now, whenever blood flows in the parallel circuits, it means from the first vessel, it will give multiple branches in which blood flows in the parallel, and then it will enter into the another vessel. Now, if we want to calculate the total peripheral resistance in this type of the circulation, then 1 divided by total resistance is equal to 1 divided by resistance of the first vessel, resistance of the second, resistance of the third vessel, resistance of the fourth vessel, and so on. So in this manner, we can calculate the resistance of the blood flow in the series and in the parallel vascular circuits. Now let's solve some frequently asked MCQs. First MCQ, Poiseuille's law is. So as you all know, Poiseuille's law, F, that is flow rate, is equal to PA minus PB, that is the pressure at the A end, pressure at the B end, multiplied with pi r s to 4 divided by 8 eta l. Always remember Poiseuille's law because it is a frequently asked question in the MCQ exams. If diameter of a vessel it is increased double, then options are blood flow increases fourfold, blood flow decreases fourfold, blood flow increases 16-fold, and blood flow decreases 16-fold. So whenever diameter of the vessel it is increased double, then diameter or the radius of the vessel it is directly related to the flow rate. So Q is equal to PA minus PB multiplied with pi r s to 4 divided by 8 eta l. So whenever radius is increased double, then the blood flow it increases 16 times. Law of Laplace. First understand that law of Laplace, it describes relationship between the distending pressure, tension in the wall and its radius. So why we have to understand about the law of Laplace? Because in our body, spherical organs as well as the cylindrical vessels, they are present. Now inside the vessel as well as the spherical organ, distending pressure it is present, and the wall of the vessel as well as the organ, they contain tension inside the wall. So pressure it always try to distend the hollow viscus as well as the vessel, and the tension inside the wall it try to compress the organ as well as the vessel. And its relationship with the radius of the organ or the vessel. So all this relationship, they are described by law of Laplace. So according to law of Laplace, T or the tension in the wall of the cylinder is equal to product of the transmural pressure and the radius divided by wall thickness. Now this transmural pressure is equal to pressure inside the cylinder minus pressure outside the cylinder, and W is the wall thickness. Usually the pressure outside the cylinder as well as the wall thickness, they can be ignored. So tension in the wall of the cylinder is equal to pressure inside the cylinder multiplied with the radius of the cylinder. Now let's understand the difference in the relationship between the tension and the pressure in the cylindrical as well as the spherical vessels. So the wall tension, it is related to the distending pressure multiplied with the radius. So distending pressure P is equal to wall tension divided by radius. So we can write it like that. Distending pressure P is equal to tension multiplied with 1 divided by R1 plus 1 divided by R2. Because radius in the spherical vessel as well as the cylindrical vessel, they are different. For the sphere, radius, they are similar in all the dimensions. So for the sphere, R1 is equal to R2. So P is equal to 2T upon R, or T is equal to PR divided by 2. Now for the cylinder, one radius is infinite. So here we can see the distending pressure is equal to wall tension divided by R. So T is equal to PR. So we can say that tension in the spherical vessel is half of the tension which is present inside the cylinder. Here we can see T is equal to PR, and here T is equal to PR divided by 2. So tension in the spherical vessel, it is half of the tension which is present in the cylindrical vessel. So for the spherical organs or the hollow viscus, T or the wall tension is equal to distending pressure multiplied with the radius. Wall viscosities like bladder, ventricle or the alveoli of the lungs. Now here we can see this is a spherical organ. T is the tension in the wall of the hollow viscus. P is the distending pressure inside the hollow viscus. And R is the radius of the hollow viscus. So the tension in the wall of the organ, it is related to the distending pressure and the radius of the organ. So whenever radius of the hollow viscus, it increases tension inside the wall of the hollow viscus. And whenever radius decreases, it decreases the tension of the wall of the hollow viscus. Now let's understand what happens in the patient with the cardiac failure whenever dilatation of the heart occurs. So here we can see the distending pressure, radius and the wall tension. So whenever dilatation of the heart or the ventricle occurs, it increases the radius of the organ. And with the increase in the radius of the organ, it increases the wall tension, because wall tension T is equal to distending pressure multiplied with the radius. So whenever radius increases, it increases the wall tension. Now because wall tension, it is more energy it is required to pump blood in the systemic circulation. Therefore, a dilated or distended heart, it pumps blood less efficiently. Law of Laplace also explains that why thin walled capillaries, they are less prone to rupture. Now for the cylindrical vessels, tension in the wall is equal to distending pressure multiplied with the radius. So whenever radius of the vessel is less, for example in the capillaries or in the small vessel, wall tension it is also less. So the less tension in the wall, it is necessary to balance the distending pressure. So that's why thin wall capillaries, they are less prone to rupture. Now one MCQ from this topic. Law of Laplace, all except P is equal to T divided by R, P is equal to 2T upon R, T is equal to PR divided by W, and T is equal to WP divided by R. So according to the Laplace law, T is equal to PR divided by W. So P is equal to T upon R and P is equal to 2T upon R for the law of Laplace in the spherical organ as well as in the cylindrical vessels. But T is equal to WP divided by R. This is the wrong. So the answer is Bernoulli's principle. Now Bernoulli's principle, it explains the relationship between the pressure as well as the velocity of the blood. According to the Bernoulli's principle, the total pressure in a closed system, it remains always constant. So here we can see this is the total pressure in the closed system and it is always remain constant according to the Bernoulli's principle. Now this total energy or the total pressure in a tube at any given point, it equals to the sum of the potential energy and the kinetic energy. Here we can see this is the dynamic pressure and LP is the lateral pressure. So total pressure is always constant and it is equal to the dynamic pressure as well as the potential energy. Now the potential energy of a fluid in a tube, it comprises of hydrostatic pressure as well as the lateral pressure. So potential energy is equal to hydrostatic pressure plus lateral pressure. Now first of all, understand about the hydrostatic pressure. Hydrostatic pressure, it results from difference in vertical height in a fluid filled system. So in simple terms, it is the pressure exerted by the column of the water because of the difference in the gravitational effect. So the magnitude of the gravitational effect is 0.77 mmHg per centimeter of distance from the heart. Now understand it by the example. Here we can see the heart as well as the circulatory system. Now at the level of the heart, this is the reference point. So the venous pressure, it is zero. Now as we go below from the heart towards the lower limb, because of the positive gravitational effect, blood pressure increases. So at the distance of about 100 cm below the level of the heart, venous pressure is plus 80 mmHg and the arterial pressure is 200 divided by 160 mmHg because of the positive gravitational effect. Now as we go above the reference level or from the heart, then at the distance of about 50 cm, venous pressure is minus 37 mmHg and the arterial pressure is 80 divided by 40 mmHg. So the magnitude of the gravitational effect is 0.77 mmHg per centimeter of the distance from the heart. It is because of the presence of the positive as well as the negative gravitational effects. Lateral pressure is the pressure exerted by the column of the blood with the elimination of the hydrostatic pressure effects. Because potential energy is equal to lateral pressure plus hydrostatic pressure. So when the hydrostatic pressure is the zero, then the measured potential energy is equal to lateral pressure. So here we can see the recording of the blood pressure at the level of the heart. Now, as we all know, at the reference level, hydrostatic pressure is zero. So when we measure pressure at the level of the heart, then it gives the amount of the lateral pressure exerted by the column of the blood. That is the blood pressure, and that's why blood pressure, it is always measured at the level of the heart, because at the level of the heart, hydrostatic pressure is zero. Now look at this given figure and understand about the Bernoulli's principle. So according to Bernoulli's principle, total pressure, it is always constant in a closed system. Now in this given glass tube, there are two different portions. In this first portion diameter, it is more than the second portion. And because of the horizontal situation of this glass tube, the hydrostatic pressure of this closed system, it is zero. Now here, look at the first part. This is the total pressure, and total pressure is equal to dynamic pressure plus lateral pressure. Now whenever diameter of the vessel decreases, then velocity, it is inversely related to the cross-sectional area. So because of the decrease in the diameter of the vessel, velocity of the fluid inside this closed system, it is increased. So here again, look at the measured total pressure. Total pressure, it remains constant, but there is change in the composition of the total pressure, that includes dynamic pressure as well as the lateral pressure. Here we can see that dynamic pressure increases because of the increase in the velocity of the fluid in the system, and the lateral pressure decreases. So total pressure, it remains constant, but whenever velocity increases, then dynamic pressure increases and the lateral pressure decreases. And this is explained by the Bernoulli's principle. Now we will utilize all the information from the Bernoulli's principle to understand why acute myocardial infarction is common in the patient with the aortic stenosis. So here we can see the root of the aorta. This is the aortic valve, and these are the coronary arteries. Now coronary arteries, they are situated at the right angle of the aorta. So whenever aortic stenosis, it is present, then the velocity of the fluid, it increases inside the aorta. And with the increase in the velocity of the fluid, lateral pressure inside the coronary artery, it decreases because of the increase in the dynamic pressure. And because of the decrease in the lateral pressure, coronary arteries, they receive less blood, and because of that, perfusion to the heart also decreases. And that's why in the patient with the aortic stenosis, acute myocardial infarction is common.